يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات والله بما تعملون خبير.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، رب السماوات ورب الأرض، رب العرش العظيم، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله هو الحق المبين، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، ف today's lesson we are on فصل في الحوالة. الحوالة you can say it in two ways، حوالة or حوالة، they're both correct. And الحوالة it comes from the word التحويل. التحويل means to change, to move from. It means a change. Okay, that's what التحويل means. And in the Sharia, in fiqh, when we talk about al-hawala, what it means is moving, so the changing a debt from your neck to someone else's neck. Okay, it is changing a debt from your neck to someone else's neck. يعني from your what's the word for that in Arabic in fiqh that we use for dhimma? The word dhimma. I like to use dhimma easier instead of neck. It's not really good translation, but if you guys understand what it means. طيب. So from using it from your dhimma to someone else's dhimma. From your neck to someone else's neck now. It's not on you anymore. And this is something that is narrated by the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, he said, مَطْلُ الْغَنِيِّ ظُلْمٌ فَإِذَا أُحِيلَ وَفَإِذَا أُتْبِعَ أَحَدُكُمْ عَلَى مَلِيءٍ فَلْيَتْبَعَ أو فَلْيَحْتَلْ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the matl, if a person has a debt, al-matl, what it means is a person has a debt and he's rich, he has money, but he doesn't want to pay it back. He said, I'll pay it back tomorrow, later. He has money and the debt is come. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the matl of the ghani, the one who's rich, is dhulm. For him to do that, say later on, is oppression. Then he says, فَإِذَا أُحِيلَ أَحَدُكُمْ وَفَإِذَا أُتْبِعَ أَحَدُكُمْ عَلَى مَلِيءٍ. If one of you is told to go get your debt from someone else, then you should go and do it. The point is here, al-hawala, what it is very, very يعني, concisely, is for someone who has a debt. For example, I owe Abdullah £500. I owe Abdullah £500. Okay? I owe him £500. Abdurrahman owes me £500. So what do? I do hawala. I say to Abdullah, go get your money from Abdurrahman. That's called hawala, and there's conditions for it. Is that clear? Everyone knows what hawala is. Is that clear? Yeah? That's what it is. طيب, so he says, وَشَرَائِطُ الْحَوَالَةِ أَرْبَعَ. There are four conditions for it to be correct. Number one is رِضَى الْمُحِيلِ. The one who is being told to go and get the debt, he must be pleased with it. يعني It must be acceptance, basically, on all sides, on all parties. Al-muhili is the one who is la al-muhali alayhi muhtal. Al-muhili, al-muhili is the one who is giving telling the person to go to the next person. Okay, so he said أربعة هي ثلاث وهي ثلاثة لأن رضا المحيلي والمحتال شرط واحد. So it's actually one condition, basically. So it says رضا المحيلي وقبول المحتال. So for a person, for the person who's telling you, for you, you're telling to go get the debt. The one who is you're telling to go get the debt, and the one who has the debt in the first place. So me and Abdullah, we both must be accepted, basically. يعني I have to accept that I'm telling you to go get debt, and you have to accept that I'm going to get the debt from Abdurrahman instead. Why? Because Abdurrahman, he might be someone who doesn't pay debts off. So how can I now tell you to go and get your money of a person who you don't know? Right? If you accept it now, then the contract is correct. Right? طيب, do you understand that? The point is here, the one who I'm sending to go get a debt, I owe him money, I said go get a debt from the other person, the loan, go get it from someone else, that person must accept it. And the reason why they mentioned that is because of the hadith, the reason why it's important to understand is because the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, فَإِذَا أُحِيلَ أَحَدُكُمْ عَلَى مَلِيءٍ فليتبع. If a person of إذا أتبع أحدكم على مين فليحتل. If a person is sent to go get his money from someone else, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he commanded you to do it, right? He said فليحتل, accept it. Does that show that it's obligatory? According to the Hanabila, yes, it's obligatory. According to the Hanabila, they say that it is obligatory, but the correct opinion, Allahu A'lam, is the majority. Majority of the scholars, they say that you don't have to accept it, it's mustahab, it's sunnah to accept it. But the Hanabila, they say, because the hadith, it says that you accept it, so they say you have to accept it, even if you don't know who the guy is, right? If you're sent to someone who is known, sorry, not if you, even if you don't know who the guy is, sorry, that's not what they say. They say that you have to accept it. If you know that person is mali, yani he pays his debts, you have to accept it. Okay? But the correct opinion is, again, the majority is what? Is that he doesn't have to accept it. Abdullah doesn't have to accept to go get the debt from that person. Is that clear? So, رضا المحيلي وقبول المحتال.
Listen, sisters are asking, what page is it on?
I don't know.
It's 113 at least.
113 on the blue.
17 and 106.
113 in the Matn Dar Minhaj, and yeah, and the English translation is
782.
So
can you in this three, can you give the names of each person?
English.
Yeah.
If there's any more books, if there's any books for the English sister side that are not needed, then just send it back, inshallah. If not, then we'll order more, inshallah, next time. طيب. المحتال عليه is the one who is being sent. Is being sent to. يعني عبد الرحمن. عبد الرحمن. والمحيل is the one sending. والمحتال. Yeah, it's me. والمحتال is the one being sent. محيل, المحيل. اسم فاعل, right?
سيد المحتال إليه.
المحتال عليه هو محتال إليه عبد الرحمن. Yeah. طيب. He's the one that is being sent to. So he said the condition is what? رضا المحيل والمحتال. طيب. وكون الحق مستقرا في الذمة. The second condition is that the debt, the money that is owed, it is in his ذمة. He actually owes it right now. It is in, not right now, but it is owed. يعني it's not something that is not owed yet, it's going to be owed later on. For example, a person, he says, I'm going to buy something from you, but get your money from that person. I've done the Hawala, right? But I said, I'm going to buy something for you. You don't owe me anything, the contract hasn't been done. It has to be on the day of the contract. When the contract is done, then now we can add to the contract, the person's going to do Hawala. We can add the contract of Hawala. When we mention these issues, we are mentioning them in the case of in a case of a court, يعني in amongst the mahkamah and the court. Right now, if I say to you, go get your money from that person, it doesn't mean anything to me. It doesn't mean anything to you or to anyone. When we are now buying and selling, we are now at the majlis, we're actually giving the money, we're giving this, we're taking, we're agreeing, we're signing the contract. This is when now the conditions are now mu'tabara, they're considered. Before that, if I said, I'm going to do a contract with you, and when I do the contract, I'm going to do hawala with you, I'm going to say, go get the money from that person. When the day of the contract comes, is that binding on me? It's not binding. You understand why we say that? That's why the right, at the time of the agreement of the contract, it must be there. And if I say to you, I'm going to buy something from you later on, and I'm going to do hawala with you, that means nothing until the time of the contract. At the time of the contract, is the right there or not? Do you owe something? Are you gonna owe something? He said no. In that case, you have no right to do hawala until the money is going to be owed. Is that clear? طيب. When it comes to questions, only questions that are to do with the issue is until the end. Okay. يعني if you don't sign something, nah. Is it until the end? You can save it to the end.
Yeah.
Okay. Write it down. So you don't forget it. طيب. شرط الثاني كون الدين مستقرا على ما ذكره. For example, the dain of a man who married a woman, he married a wife. This is what we mean by istiqrar. يعني it's in his, he actually owes it right then and there. When a person says, "I'm going to pay mahar," when is the mahar obligatory? And he's married. He gets married to the woman. When is it, at the marriage, or when is it? Is it a divorce? Agreed upon?
During the marriage.
During the marriage? When? When the time of the marriage? First minute? First 10 minutes?
No, any from when you're married until.
From marriage, so from the contract, yani. From when you say qabl to.
Yeah, after.
Qabl
is something that's
agreed upon. The mahar is obligatory, it's on your neck. عند الدخول. When a person has intercourse with the wife. That is when the mahar now is on your neck. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ تَمَسُّهُنَّ فَمَا النَّاسِ إِدَّةِ It's talking about the ayah in the Quran. It says, وَإِن طَلَّقْتُمُهُنَّ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَن تَمَسُّهُنَّ If you divorce a woman before you touch them, وَقَدْ فَرَضْتُمْ لَهُنَّ فَرِيضًا, and you said they're going to give a mahar this much, فَنِصْفُ مَا فَرَضْتُمْ, you only have the half. And if you didn't say anything, you just said mahar, there was no mahar mentioned. The next ayah, فَنِصْفُ مَا فَرَضْتُمْ إِلَّا أَن تَعْفُونَ وَيَعْفُوَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ عُقْدَةُ النِّكَاحِ وَأَن تَعْفُوا أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى وَإِن طَلَّقْتُمُوهُنَّ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَن تَمَسُّوهُنَّ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَن وَلَمْ تَفْرِضُوا لَهُنَّ فَرِيضَةً بس آية بفور وَإِن طَلَّقْتُمُوهُنَّ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَن تَمَسُّوهُنَّ أَوْ تَفْرِضُوا لَهُنَّ فَرِيضَةً أو تفرضوا لهن فريضة فمتعوهن على الموسع قدره وعلى المقتر قدره. So يعني if you now you married someone and you didn't say a mahr, there's no mahr mentioned, then you don't have to pay anything except for what is according to عرف before you touch them. طيب.
When you said no mahr, are you talking about not specific amount?
Yeah, no amount was mentioned.
Oh, no.
If you made a condition, then you have to pay that condition, that amount. But if you did mention it and you didn't enter into upon the woman, then you only have to pay half. إلا أن يعفونا unless she forgives. She is allowed to forgive that. أو يعفو الذي بيده عقد النكاح. The point is now the mahar, when does it become مستقر في الذمة? When does it become in your ذمة? You owe it after الدخول. So now, someone now, he says that I'm going to, according to this condition, according to this, before the marriage, he says the mahar is this much, but you have to get it from that person. Then they get married. Is that hawala correct? No, it's not correct. It has to be after the marriage. And according to some scholars, after الدخول as well. Because if you take the opinion, it is مستقر. Okay? Exactly.
How would you write that?
Third condition. The right must be on your neck. You must owe it. Yeah, and you can't be before you owe it. You can't tell someone to go get the money from this person before you actually owe the money. Exactly.
So after the marriage, they don't agree that one of the parties don't agree that I'm gonna get the mahar from them. If they
already accepted the hawala, they've already accepted this hawala, then they can't disagree now. You have to get it. And it's off my neck now. I said to my wife, this money I owe you, go to get it from this person. She says, I accepted that. It's off my neck. I'm not going to be accepted. I'm not going to be.
Well, the
Hanbali,
they say that you have to accept it.
Yeah, they say you have to accept it. Yeah.
So then, what about if someone's deceitful?
They say you have to accept if you know that the person who you're being sent to is someone who pays, actually would pay, and the person that you told that he owes you money, obviously he owes you money, you know.
But isn't the second condition
is
that the money has to be owed at the current time? Okay, it has to happen.
Yeah.
So
what was
the third one?
Now on the third one. واتفاق ما في ذمة المحيل والمحال عليه في الجنس والنوع والحلول والتأجيل. Is that the debt that I owe, that the person who is sending someone, the muhal or the muhil, يعني the one who's sending someone, I owe Abdullah money. Remember what I mean. I owe Abdullah 500 pounds. Abdurrahman owes me 500 pounds. The money that I owe Abdurrahman and the money that I owe Abdullah must be the same. Must be the same. يعني right now, if I owe Abdullah a Volkswagen Golf and he owes me a Volkswagen Polo, can I do ihala to him? No, it has to be the same type of money. Exactly the same type of wealth. Right? If I owe him $500 and he owes me £500, can you do halal? No. You understand? If I owe him £10,000 worth of gold and he owes me £10,000 worth of silver, it's not allowed. It has to be the same. Why? Just so there's no arguments between the people. Exactly.
So
What if, let's say, the not about currency, but value. Let's say you owe someone, someone owes you like £10,000, but the person would just want 1,000.
He just wants 1,000?
Yeah, the person that you are going to tell to collect with the other person just wants £1,000.
Even then, you have to wait, it has to be?
The exact amount.
No, yani if this, if it's less, then it's okay. If it's less, is it okay? Allahu A'lam, actually. We'll check that, inshallah. Allahu A'lam. But here they say that it has to be the same. Well, if it's less, if it's more, then it's not allowed.
Do you get my question?
Yeah, I get it.
As in,
he owes, I owe him £500, and he owes me £1,000.
Yeah.
So I say to him, go get your £500 from him, and then he's going to give me the rest of the £500.
Yeah.
Allahu A'lam. Yeah.
Well, what's the likelihood of it being the same amount? Because say someone owes you like £340.
That's why the question. To be honest, I had an answer, but it's in my head. But like, I want to double check it, and it's, I don't want to speak without knowledge. And I want to double check it. I had an answer, but because I was reading about this, but I don't want to, I think, say it, inshallah. طيب في النوع والحلول والتأجيل وتبر. طيب, what's the result of these three conditions? وَتَبَرَأُ بِهَا ذِمَّةُ الْمُحِيلِ. The result of this is that now the one who sent someone to go collect the money, he no longer owes any money. Right now, I owe Abdullah £500. I said, go collect your £500 from Abdurrahman. He says, I accept it. He has nothing to do with me now. Abdurrahman doesn't want to pay him, it's nothing to do with me. Ask him. He is the one who accepted it. He shouldn't have accepted it. You understand? So, the تَبَرَأُ بِهَا ذِمَّةُ الْمُحِيلِ. In terms of مُطَالَبَ, he can't come back to me and say, give me the money. If Abdurrahman goes and he loses his money, that's him. That's you and him. Nothing on me anymore. Is that clear?
Can the transaction only be money?
No, it's not only money. Any type of wealth.
So which one is al-muhil? Al-ladhi ursila?
Al-muhil is me. Al-muhil is me. The one sent him.
The arsala al-muhtal.
Al-muhtal is one sent. You all sent.
I'm sent.
Yeah. Al-muhil is me, the one sending. The muhal is one, the muhtal is the one being sent. Wal muhalu alayhi is the one being sent to. طيب, is that clear?
So say for example.
Yeah. I say go send, and before the majlis finishes,
yeah.
He says, no, I don't want anymore. It's not lazim. It's khiyar, yeah, khiyar shart.
So all the freedom or just two or one?
Khiyar al-majlis, khiyar shart. لا لا إذا خيار المجلس الله أعلم في الخزيرة الله أعلم نعم
الخيار has to be set condition before he goes
no yeah no no it's just there يعني if say Abdullah said accept it and he doesn't leave the room and then he says no I don't want anymore then
it's what about if I say you can think about it for a day
yeah he's allowed then he hasn't accepted it yet طيب is that clear that's the quick مسألة of الحوالة طيب next مسألة is الضمان the issue of الضمان نعم هو تحول الحق المحتال إلى ذمة المحال إلى أن ذلك فائدة الحوالة تستبين باب حوالة طيب فصل في الضمان الضمان is another contract of توثيق do you guys remember the contract of توثيق what was it again what's توثيق رهن ضمانا كفالة right what is a contract of توثيق again
a guarantee
remember the guarantee for someone to guarantee his right that it's going to be paid. And the contract of daman is to guarantee your money is going to be safe. What's the surah of that? How does that look? It is, if a person, he owes me, Abdullah owes me, or money. Oh, sorry, I want to buy something off Abdullah. I want to buy something off him. No. Because we're just speaking about it today. Where's the brother, the Nasr? The guarantor. It's a guarantor. Yani, if a person, he wants to go buy a house, and he's going to pay in installments, and I don't trust this person's credit score, or something like that. I don't trust this person what he has. So I say, bring me a guarantor. Someone who's going to, I can go to him if you don't pay out. So that person becomes a ضامن. He becomes a ضامن. And what happens is that, If you don't pay, then I can go to get money from him. He becomes, and he has to accept it, of course. So you get it? Or, مثلاً, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when Abu Qatada, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going to pray janazah on a man, and then he turned around and he said, does he have any debt? So they said, yes, three dinar, three gold coins. So the Prophet says, Sallu ala sahibikum, pray on him. I'm not praying upon him because he died with a debt. That shows how bad dying on a debt is. He died with a debt, I'm not praying upon him. So Abu Qatada said, Ya Rasulullah, I'm going to take that. I'm going to take that debt of him. So Abu Qatada began it, Dhamin, of money. He said, I'm going to pay it off for him. You understand?
Does that not have to be set before though?
No, it has to be set before. It can be. After.
So it could be like, say someone owes 50k.
Mm-hmm.
It can happen there and then. Like,
yeah, yeah.
Someone can say,
I'll take it with me about. And some scholars, they even say that he can even do it without your permission. Yeah, and someone can say, for example, I hear that Abdullah owes someone £10,000. I go to that person and say, look, I'm paying on his behalf. I'm a Bahmin. Understand?
Well, without him knowing.
Salat. Yeah, Salat. What's wrong with that? Yani, someone paying you.
Might not like want them to act in
Salat. Yeah, yeah. Like in Salat. It's Salat. Tayyip.
Does it have to be known to him that his debt has been paid off?
No, it doesn't have to be known.
So you could end up paying twice as much if that makes sense.
Yeah, and he might pay back and then he pay back. Yeah. Yeah, that person should be responsible. Said the guy already paid you.
Yeah.
And you should tell him. Like in, yeah.
But if it's anonymous, like.
Doesn't have to be known. Doesn't have to be known. And the only issue is that if it is known or not, they mentioned the issue of, do I have to pay it back? Now if I go to Abdullah, they're both Abdullah. If I go to Daniel and I pay off Abdullah's debt, okay? I pay off his debt. And then I say, I want my money back. Let me go to Abdullah, you owe me 50,000. You understand?
Can you do that?
You don't have to do that? You only have to do if he told him. Yeah, and if he became a dhamin at the beginning, before he took the debt, he said, Yasin, become my dhamin. So I said, okay, I accept it. Then, when it came to the time of paying, I said, Abdullah, I'm paying on your behalf. Are you paid? Then I said, can you give my money back now? It's a lot in that case. Okay. But yeah, in that case, it's a lot.
He's passing on debt.
As for, if he doesn't tell you I'm a dhamin, he just comes and he pays on your behalf. In that case, it's tabarru, it's charity. You're not to ask for it back. And Hanabila, they put another shart which is good, which is say, إِنَّ وَالرُّجُوعُ, if he intended to get money back. And when I'm paying off my money, and I'm paying off the guy's debt, I intended that I'm going to get money back. In that case, he's allowed to go back and get money back from the person. طيب?
You have to announce the intention.
No, he has to just have it in his heart. And no one can know that except for Allah. طيب, quickly.
Muslims can give some rahm, isn't it the same thing?
No, rahm, you give something as a guarantor. You give something, you take it. Rahan is something, you give something. I give someone my phone. Here, take my phone. If I don't pay you back, you can sell the phone. That's different. This is a person taking over the money. I'm going to pay the money back on the person's behalf. طيب. He said, وَيَصِحُّ ضَمَانُ الدُّيُونِ الْمُسْتَقِرَّةِ إِذَا عُلِمَ قَدْرُهَا. The first condition is that it has to be مُسْتَقِرَّة. It has to be on your neck. يعني you can't say, you can't be a ضامن of a دين that's not there, of a debt that's not even there. And he said, if that happens, I'm going to be a ضامن. Then when it happens, is he a dhamin? No, he's not. He might have promised, but again, in front of the courts, is he a dhamin? No, he's not. He doesn't have to pay the debt for that person's behalf. He doesn't have to pay the debt on that person's behalf. Second condition is that عُلِمَ قَدْرُهَا. You have to know how much the debt is. And someone says, he goes to Abdurrahman, and he says, don't worry, man, I've got your debt. And he goes to the bank, and how much is it? £100,000. What? why is that? Why does he have to know? Because there's gharar here. There's gharar. Remember gharar? No, gharar is ambiguity. Ambiguity. There's ambiguity. And what that leads to? He'd be like, sorry, I can't. And then I'd be like, but bro, I made plans already. You understand? It causes enmity between the people. So you have to know how much it is. إِذَا عُلِمَ قَدْرُهَا. طيب. What's the result of that? He says, وَلِصَاحِبِ الْحَقِّ مُطَالَبَةُ مَنْ شَاءَ مِنَ الضَّامِنِ وَالْمَضْمُونِ عَنْهُ إِذَا كَانَ الضَّمَانُ عَلَى مَا بَيَّنَّا. He said, the one who is owed money, what's the result of now me being a dhamin? The one who is owed money, he is allowed to come and seek the repaying from anyone. He can seek it from me, even though debt wasn't from me, but I became a dhamin. He can seek it from me, or he can seek it from the person who actually owes money. He can seek from whoever he wants, whichever one he wants. When it comes the time when the debt is due. Right? And obviously, if he does come to me, the one who's the dhamin, then I guess what do? I tell Abdullah, your guy, he came to me, I'm going to pay him, you have to pay me back. You understand? I call him, you understand? That's what it is. Not just the fact that he can come and take your money and Abdullah's free now. No. It means that he has to, he's allowed to seek his money from whoever he wants. إِذَا كَانَ عَلَى مَا بَيَّنَّا, if those conditions are there. Is it about the lesson, about this point.
Yeah. So, dhamin, it's not
the deen doesn't automatically go off that person.
Mm-mm. It doesn't go off that person. It's not like hawala.
Okay, so it's basically like
a guarantor. If you don't pay back, then I'm in trouble.
Well, he still owe you money though.
He would owe me money as well. But in front of the courts, now, for example, now, we went to a shop, we were buying a car. They said, okay, that person you owe the money, who's going to be your guarantor is going to pay? But if he does, so Abdullah, he's buying the car, Yasin is the guarantor. What happens when he owes the money, he didn't pay. And they take him to court. They say he doesn't have the money to pay. Who's the guarantor that signed for it? Yasin, bring him to court, he has to pay. Then, وَإِذَا غَرِمَ الضَّامِنِ we're going to talk about this, you have to pay now, inshallah.
What if the
barman
doesn't have the money?
Yeah, then they're both in debt.
So who does the debt lie on them?
Both of them. It's on they're both with the next.
The same amount, they've
got to pay
two thousand.
Yeah, they don't have to pay. They don't have to pay. They're both now being they're gonna be held. And whatever the court decides to do, the court can make both of them bankrupt. Oh, yeah. Understand? Oh, yeah. Both can do hajar. You know how you remember hajar?
Yeah.
Yeah, they both get hajar on them. Understand? Yeah. Things like that. But obviously when kind of the usatin, another turn ila misara. Person doesn't have money and he has hajar on him, then you have to wait now. Court has to wait.
So more than one person be the
dhamin. Yeah, more than one person can be the dhamin. طيب, then he says, وَإِذَا غَرِمَ الضَّامِنِ طيب, now I pay back the money. The dhamin, he paid back the money. And he lost a lot of money. Like, £50,000, he just lost £50,000. What happens? رَجَعَ عَلَى الْمَضْمُونِ عَنْهُ إِذَا كَانَ الضَّمَانُ وَالْقَضَاءُ بِإِذْنِهِ He goes back to the one who he paid on his behalf. So I paid £50,000 for Abdullah. I go back to Abdullah, I say, give me my money. رَجَعَ عَنْهُ, okay? إذا كان with the condition now. This is the condition. What's the condition I mentioned before? If he
accepts
and he accepts it, he gives me permission to pay back on his behalf. But he says إذا كان الضمان والقضاء. The original ضمان was with his permission. Meaning, what does that mean? The original ضمان at the time of the contract when I said I'm going to be a guarantee on his behalf, it was with his permission. I didn't go and do it just like that. Without telling him, I told him, look, okay, I'll be your guarantee. And also when he was paying off, I also told him, I'm gonna pay now. I'm paying the guy, you owe me this much money. So he paid off. In that, when those two are met, then you can get your money back. You understand that? Is that clear?
Yeah.
He has to pay you back,
yeah.
Because of debt. What did you say, like, you don't need to pay back, it's okay.
No, he doesn't have to, of course, that, and he owes you, basically.
Okay.
Is that clear?
So if he falls as a guarantor,
huh?
Then, and you actually end up paying off the debt, then the
other
guy owes you.
Yeah, he owes you. Okay. With the condition of what? He knew that I was being a guarantor, and he knew that I was paying back.
Yeah.
Yani, right now, I'm buying a car. I don't have... The person thinks I don't have enough money. So he says, bring someone who's going to be a guarantor that I can go seek my money from if you don't pay it back. So what do? I bring a brother. Bring Abdurrahman, bring Abdullah now. Go to another person. Go to Abdurrahman. We get Abdurrahman, he becomes a guarantor. Tayyib. On the time when the debt is due, I don't pay it back. He goes to Abdurrahman goes and pays it back. Jazanda. So far. Tayyib. At the time of the contract, when I wanted to become a dhamin, Abdurrahman, when I needed someone to be a guarantor for me, Abdurrahman, he came and he told me, I'm a guarantor on your behalf. He told me, okay? That's the first condition, he has to have told me. If he didn't tell me, and he just became a guarantor, and then he pays it back, can he now come and say, I paid this debt on your behalf, you have to pay me back? No, because he didn't tell me. Why are you not telling me that you're going to become the guarantor? He paid on your behalf. Mm-hmm. That's the first one, huh? Wait, what, at what time did he have to tell me? At the beginning of the contract, huh? At the beginning. They went paying it off now as well. He told me at the time of the contract that I'm a guarantor, but then, randomly, he just came and he paid off the debt. And he didn't tell me. Okay? He didn't tell me. According to what they said in the matn, then he also doesn't... In this situation, he's not allowed to go back and get his money back. So he has to tell me at both stages. The stage of the actual contract being initiated and also the stage of paying it back. But the correct opinion is that only at the time of the contract. Because when you're a dhamin at the time of the contract, of course you're going to probably pay it back. So the correct opinion is that if he became a dhamin at the time of the contract, at the beginning, then he and then he pays off the debt, then he's allowed to go back and take his money from the one who owed money. Is that clear?
And he doesn't have to tell you at the time of paying it.
And he doesn't have to tell you at the time of paying it. Even though the different opinion on this one, amongst the Shafi'i. But when those both are present, yani he was a guarantor at the beginning, and he told me when he was paying it off, and he knew me. He had permission at both times, at both occasions. Then he's allowed, with no difference of opinion amongst the Shafi'i, he's allowed to go back and take his money back. Is that clear?
Is there a time limit that will be set? So say the person, the dhamin says, pay me back within 2 weeks.
No. In that case, he owes him money, but he can set a time limit at the contract, but he can't set at the contract. So I become a dhamin if you pay me back after I pay back in this amount of time. Like, there's no time limit after that. Mm. Is that clear?
If the financial situation of the dhamin changes, is it his responsibility or?
His responsibility. So you shouldn't be, that's why they say الضمان أوله شجاع. الضمان at the beginning you're brave. وَوَسَطُهُ at the end of it is ندامه. You start regretting. That's what they say. So don't
be a hero.
You can, sometimes you know shouldn't be a hero. But sometimes it's good. Yeah. Okay? Now Abdul Rahman.
And you said at the beginning there was two conditions.
Mm.
So, the only one that you said you must know the price.
It is taqarra, he has to be mustaqir in the dhimma. So the debt has to be actually on your neck. Can't be before, way before. طيب نعم طلع.
Oh, which one's the dhaman and which one's the dhamin?
Dhaman is the actual contract. And dhamin is the one who is being a.
Okay.
Who is actually saying, I'm going to pay on your behalf if you don't pay back.
What do you call the one?
Guarantor.
The one who.
Madmunu anhu. The one who owed the money originally. المضمون عنه المضمون عنه المضمون عنه طيب then he says ولا يصح ضمان المجهول. It's not allowed for you to be a ضامن for something that's not known. Someone says again, how much money, I don't know how much money is, but I'll be a ضامن. It's not allowed. Why? Because the fact that there is جهالة and it can cause غرض and issues. ولا ضمان ما لم يجب إلا درك المبيع. And you're not allowed to be a dhamin of something that is not in the on your neck. Right? The second condition, right? It doesn't owe. Except for darakul mabi'. What's darakul mabi'? Darakul mabi' is when a person, he's going to buy something. Okay? So dhaman is what? Someone owes money. He already owes money. Abdullah bought the product. And he said, Then he brings the dhamin after, right? He already bought the product because it's on his neck, right? And then he goes and brings the dhamin after. And that person, the dhamin, he accepts it. He accepts this dhaman, right? So he already owes the money. Not before the contract, not during, it has to be when he owes the money. Then he can get a dhamin, okay? Is that clear? طيب, except for darakul mabi'. In that case, you can have a dhamin before the actual contract. What's darakul mabi'? It is when a person, he is in a situation where he fears that what he's about to buy, it might be stolen. يعني مثلا a person, he goes to a black market and he gets a car. Not black market, but not black, black market is probably definitely stolen. Like in, let's say a person, he's never seen, a dodgy person, he just looks dodgy. Or that area looks dodgy. He doesn't like, he's got a license, nothing. He don't know. So what do you say? You say, I'm going to buy it off you, but If it ends up that this thing is stolen or it is someone else's right, مُسْتَحَقٌ لِلْغَيْرِ, it is owed to someone else. Either it's someone else's stolen car or someone else is owed that car. If I find that out, then someone has to give me the money back. Do you understand that? Someone has to give me my money back. What happens in that situation? This is called دَرَكُ الْمَبِيعِ. In that case, I say to that person, give me a guarantor, someone who's going to give my money back if I find that it's stolen. Okay?
Before the
contract. This is called darakul mabi'. This is the only exception where you're allowed to make the dhaman before the contract. Okay? You can make the dhaman before the contract. Is that clear?
The opposite is also like the guy that's selling is now having the
dhaman. Yeah, the opposite as well. Both. This is called darakul thaman.
So
darakul thaman is the opposite, and this one is darakul mabi'. Huh?
So if I'm selling something to a person and I think that his money is dodgy or.
Yeah, stolen.
So then I say that if it comes back that the money that you gave me is stolen, then you have to give me back the product.
Yeah, no, you give me someone that's going to guarantee to me that if I find out this money is stolen, he's going to give me the money. Because you got the product. He's going to give me the money now.
Oh, okay. So what do I do with the money that he gave me initially?
It's stolen, because he finds out it's stolen, so the court comes. He comes and said this car was stolen.
Yeah.
this car was stolen that you just bought, they're going to take off you, right?
No, I understand the initial one, but the opposite as well. So if I'm selling something to...
Yeah, same thing. The court is going to come and say, this money was stolen from this person.
Yeah.
So give it back.
And
you're at loss right now. You're at loss right now.
You got a diamond.
But instead, what you do, you go back to that guy who you put as a contract. Darakul Mubi.
Okay.
Is that clear? Okay.
Is it not like khiyar? The same thing?
No, it's not khiyar. Because it's like, this is now, I'm in a contract. I'm about to get into a contract. Before I get into the contract, I say, this looks dodgy. This money, this car that you have. Do you understand the car part?
Yeah.
So the other one's the one that's confusing, yeah? If he's about to pay money, that money is stolen money. He just robbed the bank.
Mm.
It's stolen money. Then the bank, they come and they take your money off you. Because that was stolen from us.
Yeah.
What do? You say, get that guy that you, I knew you were dodgy, give me that money back. Is that
it?
Exactly.
No, but you did it not, and then it happened after.
In that case, you're at loss. And he, the one who stole the money, has to pay you back. But he might not have enough money. Think that. But it's allowed. This is the man. It's extra. This is extra tawthiq. Extra, yani, we can't firm.
So
you still can go back your money, yeah. Darak al mabi'. Naam. Darak al thaman. طيب فصل في الكفالة. الكفالة. كفالة is the last contract of a tawthiq. A tawthiq was what?
Guarantee.
The guarantee, right? The rahan is guaranteed by what? By a product. You give someone something, you say, if I don't pay you back, you can take it and sell it. طيب that's al rahan. Al daman is as a money. He owes you money, you take a debt on your neck. This one is now, it is to take al kafala, it comes from the word kafil, is to look after a person. Okay? And the kafil is the one who says that I'm going to guarantee, I'm going to bring this person at the time of his court case. يعني مثلا a person commits a crime. And before he commits a crime. Then he's caught by the police. Then the investigation is going on. And so he's just in prison all that time. What can you do? You can go to the court and you say, look, this person, I need him. He needs to do something for me, this and that, whatever, whatever. Bring him out of the prison. And I guarantee, I'm his kafil, that he's going to come back at the time of his judge or his sentence, in the time of this time, whatever. You understand that? It's called kafala. And in the UK, did I have that?
No.
I mean, bail. It's not bail now.
Bail
is it. Okay. طيب. It's something like that.
It's called a bond.
A bond, huh?
Yeah.
But this one you pay money. طيب. That's what kafala is. You got kafala? Do you understand kafala is, huh? And it's all, we're gonna mention it, but you guys understand the general surah of the kafala. The kafala is someone committed a crime. He owes, he's due to be punished because of the crime that he committed. It's not all crimes, but we're gonna mention which crimes. The time of the punishment being actually implemented, what do you do? Someone comes and he says, I need this person to come out of prison. So I'll be his guarantor that he's going to come back at the time when his punishment is due. Execution, when the execution is due, I'm going to bring him back to the prison.
So you pay something or...
No, you're the guarantor now. What happens if he doesn't come back? I'm going to learn, inshallah. I'm going to learn. You're in the situation now. طيب. الكفالة. طيب. والكفالة بالبدن جائزة. So what's the difference between ضمان الكفالة? Daman is by money, kafala is by body, the actual body. You're trying to, in daman you're saying, I'm going to guarantee, I'm going to bring back the money. In kafala you're going to guarantee, you're going to bring back his body. He's actually, you have to bring up himself. You have to bring him, okay? So this way, al-kafala bil-badan, wal-damanu bil-mal. Daman comes from mal, and kafala is bil-badan, by the body. طيب? نعم. نعم. What did he say? اشترط العلم بقدر المكفول. And you don't have to know what the crime is or the money that he owes. You don't have to know that, as opposed to the man. You have to know how much money. Why? Because kafala is, this is body, whether he owes 100,000 or not. It's just, you just have to bring it back. It doesn't make a difference to you. Okay. طيب. This is wal kafala bil badani jaizatun idha kana al makful bihi haqqa adamiyin. If it is allowed, if the right that you're now going to bring is the right of a human being, either he owes money. So, you say, I'm going to bring him back to pay back the money. Or he owes حد القذف. He's going to be punished for saying that a woman committed zina. قذف is when a person, he says that this woman is she's this and that, she done zina. And it wasn't true. What happens? You're lashed 80 times. Right? So there's a punishment there. And whose right is it? That's the right of the... No, whose right is this lashing? the woman who was accused, right? He was slandered. Or qatl, he killed someone. So he killed someone, and the family, they have a right, right? That his wife is going to be executed, and we're going to learn that at the end of the book, executed, or they pay his money, whatever. So that's the human being right. حق الآدمي, human being right. The right of killing is the right of the family. So we're allowed to do kafala on this. So you can bring him back for him to be, whatever the punishment is. طيب, as opposed to the rights of Allah. If he done, it went against the right of Allah, for example, what? Ridda. He apostated. No, there's no kafala for ridda. There's no kafala for stealing. Stealing is not the right of a human being. It's the right of Allah. Someone stole. He drank alcohol. So he's supposed to be whipped, right? He ran, you know, there's no kafala for that. Do you understand? Zina, for example, zina. Someone committed zina. It's no one's rights. It's Allah. So therefore he's punished. So therefore there's no kafala for that. He's staying until he's punished. Do you understand? So it has to be the right of an adami, a human being. Like haddul qadf, like qadf, slandering a woman, because it's the right of the woman. Had, or not just a woman, a man as well. Haddul qisas, killing, and things like that. Is that clear? These are the, this is what he means by al-kafalatu bil-band jazitun idha kan al-makfulu bihi haqq adami, if it's the right of an adami. Is that clear, yeah? No. It does also come under the right of Allah, but generally it's the right of a human being. Because the right of the humans is that the wali. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ قُتِلَ مَظْلُومًا فَقَدْ جَعَلْنَا لِوَلِيهِ سُلْطَانًا. We gave his the rights to the sultan, the wali, the family of the person. Okay?
Isn't stealing the rights of the person?
No. The scholars, they mentioned that stealing is the right of Allah. Because we had the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said, Zayd ibn Thabit came and he said that, and if it wasn't the right of, if it was the right of a human being, then you could just pay him back. And you could say, okay, pay him back. But no. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Makhzumiyya, the woman from the Quraysh, from the tribe of Bani Makhzum, when she stole, Zayd ibn Thabit, Usamah ibn Zayd came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hibbu Rasulillah, the one who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam loved, and said, try to intercede on her behalf, don't cut her hand. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he say? Atashfa'u fi haddi min hududillah? Are you trying to intercede from the punishment of the punishments of Allah? It is something that he done. So he said, Wallahi lo saraqat Fatima, laqata'tu yadaha. Wallahi, if Fatima was to steal, I would cut her hand. It's the right of Allah. And if it wasn't the right of Allah, if it was the right of a human being only, then if a person now could just say, don't, because it could go to the court and say, don't cut off the hand and pay him back. But no. Once the right is brought up to the when the man stole and he was brought to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then the other person who was stolen from, he said, I forgive him. The Prophet said, no, it's done. Yeah, he was brought to me. He has to implement the had. Understand?
But what if you decide not to bring it to the
court? Yeah, if you don't bring it to the court, then it's different.
But you're allowed to not bring it to the court.
Yeah, allowed to not bring it to the court. Yes, you're allowed to not bring it to the court.
What if someone else mentions it and you don't mention it?
That's the court. That's the according to the court. Once it's taken to the court, then the court has to implement the had. They have no choice. Is that clear?
Yeah.
What's it taken? Quickly, there's a question about this subject. Yeah, yeah.
So what about the case of apostasy?
A prostitute?
No, apostasy.
Apostasy is the right of Allah.
So I'm saying, like, how would that go about? Like, would you have to publicly announce that somebody, like...
If someone is caught for saying something that's ridda,
okay,
or he says something that's apostasy, or he insults the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in public, and he's known, someone, it was proven that he'd done that, then the court has to implement the punishment for that.
Is that the first time? Do you know for kafala, are there any shurut that exempt someone from being a kafil? For example, can it be anyone?
It can be anyone who generally is able to bring back the person. We're going to mention this, that he says, well, there's someone, the person, he has to be someone that's able to bring back the person.
Even if he's like a known liar or...
No, the court is according... They say there has to be obviously a person who is... even if he's a known liar. Sah. Because that person now... Well, look, we're gonna see what he says here when he talks about how to bring him back. Look what he says here. He says, look...
Is this a condition?
No, I didn't mention the condition. بَلْ كُلُّ مَنْ وَجَبَ عَلَيْهِ حُضُورُ مَجْلِسِ الْحُكْمِ عِنْدَ الطَّلَبِ لِحَقٍ آدَمِينَ أَوْ وَجَبَ عَلَى غَيْرِ إِحْضَارُهُ صَحَّتْ كَفَالَتُهُ. Anyone who has to attend the majlis al-hukum, the court case, right? عند الطلب, when he is requested to be there, then he's allowed to be a kafil. So for example, someone who is unconscious on a bed, or not unconscious, he's paralyzed. He's not able to get to the court case. He's not able to get there. He's not physically able to get there. He can't be a kafil because he needs to be present at that court case. Why? Because if that person, the other person doesn't come, then he's going to be held for that. طيب. So anyone is able to. And number two is that فلا يبرأ الكافر. And then also the person who is being brought, he, if he doesn't come, what happens? ولو غاب المكفول وجهل الكافل مكانه. If a person that needs to be brought to the case, to the court, he doesn't come, and in that situation, what happens? Now happens. There's a few situations in this situation. If a person doesn't come to court, the court case happens, and he's sought to come then and there. What happens? The first situation is that he's able to go and get him. So he says, the court, they give him, يعني, for example, let's say, I said I'm going to be a kafil for another brother. That brother's not there. The court, they come to me and they said, bring that person. That the time of the court case is happening right now. They give me the time that it takes to go to that place where he is and to bring him back. So it takes 1 day and 1 night, for example. It takes 1 day and 1 night to bring someone. They're going to give me 1 day and 1 night to bring him. Number two, the second situation is that I don't know where he is. He's gone. He ran away. In that case, they say, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. He actually doesn't know. He really doesn't know. In that situation, then the person is held. No one's held for that. The third situation is that the one who goes, the one who is supposed to be brought to the Majlis al-Hukum, he is gone. And I know where he is, and I don't bring him back. In that situation, that person, the kafil, is held and imprisoned until that person comes back. Is the punishment applied upon him? No. The punishment is not applied upon him. Yani, the qisas is not on that person who was a kafil. But he is in prison, hubisa, until that person comes back. Is that clear?
Couldn't they just cheat the system?
They could
feel like, I don't know where he is, but he actually does, and then he just goes and no one's ever accountable.
No, it's possible for a person to do that, but again, that's the right of that person, and they're going to be held for that on their judgment. فَلَوْ مَاتَكَ الْمَكْفُولُ. And if he dies, then nothing upon him, of course. The person who was supposed to be brought to the court, he dies, nothing upon him. لَمْ يُطَالِبِ الْكَفِيلِ بِالْمَالِ لَأَنَّهُ لَمْ يَضْمَنْهُ حَتَّى لَوْ اشْتَرَى نَعْمَ بِالْكَفَالَ لَأَنَّهُ يَغْمْ نَعْمَ. طيب, that is, what did we take today? الْكَفَالَ وَالضَّمَانَ وَالْحَوَالَ. We'll end it, we'll stop it there inshaAllah ta'ala. Because I know it's a bit, when it comes to these issues, the mu'amalat is a bit heavy on the head. It's a bit heavy on the head. So today we'll talk about Al-Imam Al-Bukhari. A short story of Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala. Qala al-Dhahabi, and something that's amazing that when I was reading about Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah, is the way Imam Al-Dhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala describes him. And he says about him, Imam Al-Bukhari, as we know, was the Imam of Hadith, the one who wrote the book Sahih Al-Bukhari, right? The one who wrote Sahih Al-Bukhari. Imam Al-Dhahabi rahimahullah ta'ala, he says that he was an Imam and Hafiz, and he was the Amir al-Mu'minin fi Hadith. He was the leader of the believers in Hadith. And the reasons for that are many. From amongst the stories of Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah ta'ala is that he was asked by Abu Hatim al-Razi rahimahullah ta'ala. He asked him, he said to him, when did you start seeking Hadith? So Imam al-Bukhari said, before the age of 10, I started seeking knowledge of Hadith. He said, why? He said, I was in the Kutab. I was in the Masajid. The Kutab is basically where the children used to go to learn. The Kutab is where the children used to go to learn the Quran. He said, when I was in some of the Kutab, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed me and put into my heart the love of the knowledge of Hadith. And so he said, when was the first thing that you did when you went to seek Hadith? He said, I went to the people in my city, the scholars in my city. Well, what was that show? That person, when he's seeking knowledge, wherever they are, they need to be seeking knowledge there and then as well. He said, I went to the scholars of my city until I went to a man called Al-Dakhili. And he said, Al-Dakhili, he said that he mentioned a chain of narration. And he said, from Abu Zubayr to Ibrahim al-Nakhai. And Al-Bukhari was 10 years old. And he said, that's a mistake. So the person said, be quiet, who are you, 10-year-old kid? How are you telling me what was a mistake and what's not? So Al-Bukhari said, it's a mistake because Abu Zubayr never met Ibrahim al-Nakhai. Abu Zubayr never met Ibrahim. So he said, how do you know? He went back to his book. He said, go and check your book. So the Shaykh al-Dakhili, he went back to check his book and he looked at it. And he came back and he said, how did you know? What was the correct one? I said, Imam Bukhari told him the correct chain of narration. And from then on, he put him next to him. And he sat him next to him. And Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, he tells us the story of when he started seeking knowledge. After that, he said that his mother, and before that, obviously, he was born blind. And his mother used to make dua and cry. He makes dua for his son, Imam Bukhari, Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari. He would make dua for him, and she would cry at night, making dua. And so one day at night, she saw a dream of the Prophet Ibrahim, alayhi salatu wasalam. And she said, go back and see your son, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, radda Allahu basara, Allah gave back his sight. So he went back and his sight was given back, Imam Bukhari. So he was born blind. Point is, when he went to Hajj, him and his brother Ahmed and his mother, they went to Hajj. When they went, and he was the age of 15, they went to Hajj, his mother and his brother, they went back. And he stayed and he said, فَطَلَبْتُ الْعِلْمَ فِي الْحِجَازِ. He sought knowledge in Mecca and Hijaz. Until he became the Imam that he became. And so what I wanted to bring to you guys is this story that I was amazed by of Imam al-Bukhari. That's just a quick introduction of Imam al-Bukhari was, but this story is what I really wanted to bring. Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, وَمِنْ أَعْجَبِ الْعُجَابِ مَا أَوْرَدَهُ الْخَطِيبُ الْبَغْدَادِي. Al-Khatib al-Baghdadi, he brought his chain of narration about a story of Imam al-Bukhari, from the most amazing stories of Imam al-Bukhari, about his memorization. They knew his memorization was powerful. Very, 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 very strong in hifz, in memorization. To the point that they say he memorized 600,000 hadith. 600,000 hadith. So he says, سَمِعْتُ أَبَا أَحْمَدْ إِبْنِ عَدِي يَقُولُ سَمِعْتُ عِدَّةَ مَشَايِخَ يَقُولُونَ. Ahmed, Abu Ahmed ibn Adi, he said, I heard a lot of my mashayikh, they said, إِنَّ مُحَمَّدْ ibn إِسْمَعِيلِ al-Bukhari قَدِمَ بَغْدَاد. Muhammad Ismail al-Bukhari, he came to Baghdad, Iraq. فَسَمِعَ بِهِ أَصْحَابُ الْحَدِيثِ. So the people of hadith, they heard that Bukhari is coming. And it became a big thing. Imam al-Bukhari, the Imam that was known after all his life, you know, we skipped a lot of his life. Like, after all this time, the Hafil, the one who's known, Bukhari is coming to Baghdad. So the people of hadith, they heard it. فَاجْتَمَعُوا وَعَمَدُوا إِلَى مِئَةِ حَدِيثِ. What did they do? They came and they brought, they said, let's test this man. They wanted to test Imam al-Bukhari. And so what they've done is, they got 100 hadith. 100 hadith. فَقَلَبُوا مُتُونَهَا وَأَسَانِدَهَا. They changed the matn and the asanid. What does that mean? Every hadith, it has a chain of narration, right? A chain of narration, and it has the actual hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he said. And so the way they would memorize a hadith, well, for them, one hadith is not just innamal a'malu binniyat. That's one hadith. No, for them, the first chain of narration with innamal a'malu binniyat is one hadith. The second chain of narration, which is different, and the same hadith innamal a'malu binniyat, is two hadith. And then three and four, and five, that's how each hadith was. So what did they do? They took 100 different ahadith, different matin, different wording of the Prophet ﷺ, and different chains of narration. And each person, they gave them 10 to test the Bukhari. But what did they do? They changed the chain of narration. They said, you say this hadith, inna mal a'malu binniyat, but use the chain of narration of al-Islam ibn al-Khams. Use this chain of narration. It's a different chain of narration. Right? إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ How was narrated? عُمَر بن الخطاب, إبراهيم التيمي, علقمة بن قيس, علقمة بن قيس, إبراهيم التيمي, and then the imma from there, it became a lot, right? Different people narrated the hadith. That's one chain of narration. Then you brought another chain of narration, let's say Malik, النافع عن ابن عمر, والبخاري, البخاري, Abdullah ibn Zubair, عن جابر, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's one chain of narration for a different hadith. What they do? They took this chain of narration and they put it on this hadith and this chain of narration for this hadith. So 10 people, all of them, they mentioned 10 hadith. And so they came to al-Bukhari. You see how they done. They came to al-Bukhari and they said, listen, because the way the scholars of hadith they would do is sometimes instead of the actual teacher narrating the hadith, you would read the hadith to them. And you ask them, is this your hadith? Have you heard this hadith? Have you narrated this hadith? Al-Bukhari said, yes, that's my hadith. I learned it from my Sheikh Sufyan. So the guy said, the guy he reads says, Sufyan and so-and-so and so-and-so and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, na'am, that's my hadith. Narrate it from me. I heard it from Sufyan. Narrate it from me. So what they say? They would say, فَجَعَلُوا مَتْنَ هَذَا الْإِسْنَادِ إِسْنَادٍ أَخْرُ وَإِسْنَادَ هَذَا الْمَتْنِ لِمَتْنٍ أَخْرُ وَدَفَعُوهَا إِلَى عَشْرَةِ أَنفُسِ. They gave it 10 people. لِكُلِّ رَجْلٍ عَشْرَةِ أَحَادِيثِ. Every person had 10 hadith. وَأَمَرُوهُمْ إِذَا حَضَرُوا الْمَجْلِسَ أَنْ يُلْقُوا ذَلِكَ عَلَى الْبُخَارِي. When Ibn Bukhari comes, narrate, tell him these ahadith. وَأَخَذُوا الْمَوْعِدَ لِلْمَجْلِسِ. They got a time for the gathering. فَحَضَرَ الْمَجْلِسَ جَمَاعَةٌ وَأَصْحَابِ الْحَدِيثِ. A group, a large group of people, they came. And the people of hadith, the scholars of hadith, they all came. مِنَ الْغُرَبَاءِ مِنْ أَهْلِ خُرَسَانُ وَغَيْرِهِمْ. The people of Khurasan and all of those people, they came. وَمِنَ الْبَغْدَادِيِّينَ. From the people of Baghdad. فَلَمَّا اطْمَأَنَّ الْمَجْلِسِ. When the people, they sat down, everyone's ready. Bukhari sitting down, everyone's ready. اطْمَأَنَّ الْمَجْلِسِ بِأَهْلِهِ. انتدب إليه رجل من العشرة, one of those 10 people they came, and they said, فسألوه عن حديث من تلك الأحاديث. They said about Bukhari, حديث so and so, so and so and so and so and so, فلان and فلان and فلان and فلان. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Bukhari said, لا أعرف, I don't know this hadith. I never heard of that hadith. What does he mean? It doesn't mean he didn't hear that chain of narration. You know the chain of narration. It doesn't mean he didn't hear the actual hadith, but it just means he doesn't know this tarqib, this chain of narration with this hadith. I never heard of that. I never knew that this chain of narration has, this hadith came with that chain of narration. فَمَا زَالَ يُلْقِي عَلَيْهِ وَاحِدًا بَعْدَ وَاحِدٍ حَتَّى فَرَغَ مِنْ عَشَرَتِهِ, until all 10 of them, they gave him all of the 100 hadith. وَالْبُخَارِ يَقُولُ لَا أَعْرِفُ. Bukhari said, I don't know this hadith. I never heard this hadith. People, they're shocked. Bukhari, this imam, doesn't know this hadith. Obviously, they don't know that they're tricking him. فَكَانَ الْفَهْمَاءُ مِمَّنْ حَضَرَ الْمَجْلِسِ يَلْتَفِتُ بَعْضُهُمْ إِلَى بَعْضٍ. So the people who were inside the gathering, who actually understood what's happening, they would look at each other. Are they testing Bukhari? They're looking at each other. That's the people who actually knew hadith. وَيَقُولُونَ فَهِمَ الرَّجُلِ, and they would say, and someone they would say, this guy, he knows what we're doing. This guy, someone they would say, this guy knew what we're trying to test him. He clocked. وَمَنْ كَانَ فَهِمَ مِنْهُمْ غَيْرَ ذَلِكَ يَقْضِي عَلَى الْبُخَارِي بِالْعَجْزِ وَالتَّقْصِيرِ وَقِلَّةِ الْفَهْمِ. And the other people, the rest of people who don't know what's happening, they'll say, Bukhari, this is Bukhari. Who's this guy? He doesn't even know the hadith. ثُمَّ انْتَدَبَ إِلَيْهِ الرَّجُلُ الْآخَرُ. So another person he came. So al-Bukhari, when they finished, al-Bukhari said, as for you told me the hadith with this chain of narration and this matin, but the correct one is this chain of narration with the matin. So he would repeat the chain of narration that they said to him, and he would tell them the matin that they said, the hadith that they said, and then he would give them the correct chain of narration for that hadith until he had done all of them. Alright? And that's why Imam Al-Iraqi in his Alfiyat Al-Iraqi says, he calls him Imam Al-Fanni. When they tested him, امتحن الإمام الفني فجود الإسنادة, and he made all of the asanid correct. He gave them all the 100 hadith, and he gave them all of the hadith in the correct order, the way they should have been. Imam Ibn Hajj, you guys understand what I said? I mean by that, huh? He brought, instead of the wrong chain of narration for the wrong hadith, he brought the right chain of narration for the right hadith. That's something that a lot of hufaz can do. Ibn Hajar, he comments and he said, well, ajab, the strange thing is not the fact that he knew that 100 hadith, because he was a hafiz, 600,000 hadith, he was able to do it. The ajab, the amazing thing was that he memorized the wrong chain of narration, repeated it to them, and then he gave them the right chain of narration. And so the people, that's why they said, the Amir al-Mu'minin hadith, the leader of the believers in hadith. And Iraqi praises him in lines of poetry, which I can't remember right now. The chain of narration, the lines of poetry, the Imam al-Iraqi, he praises him, and he says, فَجَوَّدْ الْإِسْنَادَ, he brought all of these chain of narration, فَهُوَ إِمَامُ الْفَنِ, he was the leader of this subject of hadith, Imam Bukhari. And if you read about the life of Imam Bukhari, you find ajab al-ujab, things that you would never think that a person, human being, could do. But the reason why he was able to do this, and others from the Salaf, like Imam Ahmad, when they said about him, Abu Zur'at al-Razi said about Imam Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala, he said to his son Abdullah, he said to his son Abdullah, he said, your father memorized 1,000,000 hadith. He said, how do you know? He said, I heard him repeat every single hadith, 1,000,000 hadith. Why were they able to do that? Not because of the fact that they were better than us in terms of their brain, just their brain. It was because of the ikhlas that they had in their heart, and because of the way that they used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you look at the connection between all of these imams, who were imams in the deen, imma in the deen, and you look at their worship, you find that their worship were at a high level. Imam Ahmad used to pray 300 rak'ah in a day. Imam al-Bukhari, he would pray all night. He said he wrote his tariq al-kabir, the history of the world. He wrote it under the moonlight in al-Medina, under the moonlight next to the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right in China, and he would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He would memorize, he would read the Quran all night. So there's a connection between a person's intention and their sincerity for the sake of Allah, and their ibadah, the way they worship, and the knowledge that they gain. Person is not worshipping Allah, he's not gaining, and he's not acting upon the knowledge that he's gaining. That person is not going to be on the level of those people who used to pray 300 rak'ah every day. Imam Abu Hanifa, they used to say about him that he would pray 300 rak'ah in the duha, at a time in the morning until al-dhuhr, he would pray 300 rak'ah in the day. Imam Ahmad, when he was, after he was beaten, he said he used to pray 300, and then when he was beaten, he became weak. He was only able to pray extra nawafil, 150 rak'ah every day. Extra. Right? And so the point is here, is that this level of knowledge is not going to be attained by people by information, mere information. You're learning, you're memorizing. is about tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you're able to actually worship Allah. You're worshiping Allah, you're asking Allah for this knowledge. That's why Ibn Taymiyyah used to say, Allahumma ya mu'allima, ya mu'allima Adam allimni, all the one who taught Adam, teach me. Wa ya mufahima Sulaiman fahimni, all the one who made it for Sulaiman, understand, make me understand. Like Allah says, fafahamnaha Sulaiman. وعلم آدم right in the Quran وعلم آدم الأسماء كلها. He says, oh, well, the one who taught Adam, teach me, the one who made Sulaiman understand, make me understand. Tell me when he wouldn't understand a mas'ala, he wouldn't understand something. He would say it's because of my sin, and so he would go to the graves, the masajid, the old masajid that were abandoned, and he would put his head, his face on the floor, humiliating himself in front of Allah, and he said, oh Allah, teach me. Because my sins have stopped me. And he said, maybe a mas'ala will come to me and I don't understand it. And I will ask Allah to forgive me 1,000 times and then I will be able to understand the mas'ala. Right? So this, the sha'an, the importance of this knowledge is not about the understanding the information, being able to show off to the people, tell the people how much you've memorized, speaking bad about the people, saying that this person is nothing, I'm better than him, I memorized all of that. La. None of this is about that knowledge, not about that. It's about how close you are going to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he said, إنما يتعلم المرء على قدر نيته. The person, the human being, he only learns according to his intention. The intention that you have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why are you learning this knowledge? That is how much you're going to learn. And the intentions for a person's knowledge, one of the main ones is what? For you to act by it. طيب. So these people, ما سبق من سبق, those people who went before us, and they went past a lot of the imams, they never went past by just by learning the information that they had, because kuffar have information, but they learned and they became imams in the deen because of the fact that they used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all the way from the time of the Salaf until today. You look at the Imam Shafi'i, Imam Bukhari, Imam Malik, the Sahaba, right? You look at their ibadah, it's the same. You don't find the person's knowledge is much, and his ibadah is nothing. You'll never find that until today. You find people like Sheikh Ibn Baz. When you hear about him, what do you hear about? You don't just hear about his knowledge. You hear about the stories of his charity he used to give, the way he used to pray. That's what you hear about. That's what's going to last. And that's what's going to keep the dhikr. You're mentioned amongst the people until the Day of Judgment. Imam Ahmad be mentioned until the Day of Judgment. Imam Shafi'i, Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, four imams. They'd be mentioned until the Day of Judgment. Why is that? Do you think just because of the information they had? Like, because of the fact that they used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us beneficial knowledge, ilm al-nafi' wal-amal al-salih wal-basirati fi al-deen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala abdi wa rasulih, nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.